we celebrated more enthusiastically, went on fireworks, everything they did. And now exhausted, some people don't want even to get out of their bed. That's fine. But we are here to glorify our Lord and God and say this day is a day of worship. And when I say that, I say with the promise of God's presence. When I say God's presence, we all have some common problem within ourselves. So before we just go into that, let me just invite you for a word of prayer and then we'll start. Loving Heavenly Father, I praise and I thank you. Lord, I submit my thoughts into thy hands and my needs and the desires into thy hands. Especially, Lord, as we are going to meditate your word, let your word speak to us, mighty Father. I bow myself and lift up your presence so that your name be glorified through us. It's your word. Lord, you speak to us. Let your word be glorifying in ourselves. In Jesus' name I pray. Just let's turn to Isaiah 41. And verse 10 we read. It's a very commonly everybody's, some people by heart they speak. Some people by heart they memorize and advise people. But in fact, nobody try to practice it. But it says, and I want this to be just taken into very serious thing. Fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. Yes, I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. This is a real word, a promising word. But in a other translation, that is amplified one, it says like this, do not fear anything, for I am with you. Do not be afraid, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. Be assured, I help you. I will certainly take hold of your hand. The hand of justice, the hand of power, the hand of victory, of salvation. So when we combine all these four, a righteous hand of justice, and the righteous hand of power, and the righteous hand of victory, and the righteous hand of salvation, combined together for our rescue. What is that we are talking about? It's just a fear. We have fear for everything. For example, I will take my own example, experience. You all know that I was driving and suddenly the light flashed on me. There was a big noise coming. I just put my brake and I was just closed my eyes. Lord, thank you, Jesus. And it flashed back to my memory. On June 2nd, we had a hailstorm for 15, 20 minutes in our Scarborough. It was so much, it was fast, the wind was. In my backyard, there was two big trees were fallen down. And I was on the 7th floor on the roof, and all of a sudden I could see it hanging in one of our branches. I don't know how I flew from that roof. I don't know how I caught hold of this branch leaf. I don't know. It was just everything in just a matter of seconds. And everything went off. And that fear is 24/7 in my mind. The sound of the wind blows. Everything was sounding like a big hails of stone. Ice was falling down from above, and everybody was screaming, running around everywhere. And I find myself hanging in a tree where the tree was broken and fallen down. Okay, I got some light bruises here and there, that's fine, but that fear was never gone out of my mind. 24/7 it was ringing in my mind. I sleep, I wake up, I work, I drive, almost 2 weeks. I couldn't able to bear it. This was a word which could able to strengthen me. That's one of the reasons why I picked this word today. It not only gave me to get out of the fear, but it gave me the solution for that fear. Last week we learned about Pastor speaking about call the presence of God, to call upon God, His presence. But this week our text shows that the solution is God's presence of God only. The solution is not something else. If you are in God's presence or God is in your with you, there is no fear can dominate you. The fear cannot be overwhelming than the presence of God. So God can subside things which we often forget to do it in our life. And mostly we say that the Lord is near. The Lord never leaves those it belongs to Him. He could always say, because God is here, we have no fear. But still, we fear, we are for everything. For example, there's a cockroach runs here. Or a rat, a mouse runs here. What will be our condition now? Either we'll be panicking or we'll be screaming. Reason? That is very small in size or anything. We can just go then stamp it and that's gone. But no, that's not the way. The fear tries to dominate because the anxiety grows up. And that anxiety makes us to think more than we act. So we get into panicking conditions. Nowadays there's a new alarm system comes as a panic button in your neck. When you are getting, just press it. Somebody will come for help. Particularly the old people, they have this panicking button. And when immediately the phone rings and they ask, are you okay now? He says, yeah, I feel something wrong. Are you okay, ma'am? Are you doing this? I do this. Okay, practice this. Get up, walk, have some water, drink, sit normally. She's panicking where to do all those things. Again, the operator calls, ma'am, did you practice it? Are you normal now? No, I'm getting shivering. Just get up, walk a little bit, have a cup of water, and sit on. Turn on your fan if you have, or anything. Or open the window, you'll be happy. But where she can't get up, where to open the window, she herself in the bed. So this is the condition which we go through in our day-to-day activities. But the Bible is different in what we as a believers will believe. The Bible says in Isaiah 41:10, I like to make everybody to read together this one more time. So if everybody has a Bible in your hands, okay. Isaiah 41, verse 10. So do not fear, for I am, do not be dismayed, for I am your God. And I will help you.
I will hold you with my righteous right
hand. This verse gives 2 commands to obey. First one is, do not fear. Second one is, do not dismayed. In other translation, I just gone through, it says, because of some unwelcome situation overwhelming. That is called dismay. So we have not welcomed the situation. So we are afraid of things. And the second part is, there are 2 reasons to obey. First one says, I am with you. The second one says, I am your God. The third part of that verse, what we read, it has got 3 promises which God will keep, not man. God will keep. I will strengthen you. I will help you. And after that, it says very wonderful word that everybody wants to be listened and practiced. He says, I will hold you with my righteous right hand. What a wonderful promises. So two things as a commands to obey, two reasons why we have to obey, and three promises which God will keep it. So when I was just going through this, the context here is God has promised people where they are in captivity, and this was prophesied 180 years before the incident could happen. Isaiah is writing this before things could happen 180 years later. He's writing now that you will be taken to Babylon as captivity, and I will bring you back. When I bring you back, this is my promise. What a gracious God we have. Nothing happened today. If I said to you, come on, man, tomorrow we don't know what it is you're talking about. Come on, let's find. In my generation, I will not see. Maybe my grandson or my great-grandchildren will see that. So I'm not worried. We just take it light. But God had a purpose in telling to his prophet to write it so that the people, when they sin and they've been taken into exile, they should not have a fear within themselves, so that the fear can go when they come back, return, and have faith in God. So God is preparing them and giving them promise that you will not be left alone. Many a times we think, particularly after this COVID-19, everybody got deserted. Nobody wants to have a social gatherings. Nobody wants to mingle each other. Nobody wants to talk to somebody closely. Nobody wants to shake hands. Nobody wants to hug each other and to say hi. The reason? Fear. What is that fear? Maybe I die. It was a big deal. Anyway, I'm going to die anyway. If not today, tomorrow I'm going to die. But I'm happy if I die, because absent from body, present with the Lord, I'll be more happy. Not to run around 8 o'clock, wake up, oh, run here, run there, do the nothing there, be happy. Yes. But with that physical desire, the desire to live, the desire to perform our own physical things, makes us to dominate and make God's presence nowhere. That's a practical thing. And when you look at this, Isaiah being referred to a Bible miniature, because 66 books, chapters he has got, and Bible has got 66 books. And he speaks about the first 39 chapter about corresponding to the Old Testament. We have 39 books as an Old Testament. And then he speaks about the days to come, the final of echoing God's presence and his things, which we read in 27 chapters, which he refers to 27 books in the New Testament. So Isaiah is not only saying something to us, he's trying to say something differently. If you read Isaiah 41 and 2, he says, comforty, comforty. My people, says your God, speak tenderly to Jerusalem and proclaim her that her heart service has been completed. Her sins have been paid for, and God is still speaking tenderly to those who are going through circumstances which is hard to them. God is speaking to him, I'll comfort you. And not only comfort you, your days are been over, your hard work is gone, your sins been paid, and there's no need to worry about it. But we are struggles between, we try to do it. But God's presence, in order that we, our family problems, in our job related problems we have, we have lack of jobs. Sometimes middle of our marriage is a mess in our marriage life. Sometimes we have in our school, we have trust in a school. Sometimes we have financial situations where we could not able to manage things. Or we have problems with our past. We have worries about tomorrow. We have worries about the things which are happening, which we are unable to control ourselves. All these worries makes us to fear more. But the word fear is, we need to understand that it is to fight back. How we fight back and how we do it, the Bible very clearly says that there is a 5 formula that we can adapt in Isaiah 41:10. That 5 formula, which I think that could help us to understand better the way in which we have to do. The first one says, we live without fear because God is with us. How many believe that? We want to go out of the fear because God lives with us. If you believe that God lives with you, you will not have fear. But do you think that we are not believing that? We believe verbally. We believe not by action. We believe it because we are Christians. We are bound to believe, hey, God is there. God is always with me. God can take care of everything. For small example, but I promise I will not say, but I'm going to say this. Hot water is on the tap, and somebody is putting their hand and saying, why this is so hot? I said, excuse me? Because you turn on hot? No. I'm imagining this. I turned only the cold. But the hot water is coming. I said, okay, let me try. So I just closed that one and I turned the cold water. You know, you are wrong. I was right because I turned on first the cold water. But the cold water didn't come first. The hot water came first. I said, what you desire is going to do it. What you don't desire is not going to happen. You turn on to something, it will come the same way. See, if you feel that God is with you, then definitely God is with you. You cannot deny that. But if you don't feel God's presence is not with you, and simply says God is with me, he's not with you. How do we do that one? He says that we must not only translate this, nothing is too fearful because God is with you. The Bible says, in the Bible, we read 365 times, fear not. How many times? 365 times it is written, fear not. My mom used to say, every day you take tablet for your thyroid at 7 a.m. And before taking that tablet, you have to take one more tablet. What is that? Tell God, fear not, take a tablet. Means every day you take fear not as a tablet in your life. So when you think, you say that fear not, then naturally you should not fear for anything. So when you don't take fear out of your thinking, then the fear will not dominate you. Then the God's presence is with us and he will lead us the whole day. And not only the whole day, whole year, every day one. That's the reason why in the Bible it's written 365 days, fear not. So every day one. So nobody can say that I have one day, one is less with me, one is more with me. No. You have all days covered. You are fully covered with one word. And that word should not dominate your life. And that word, we need to practice it. And we need to take it off. And friends, in order to face fear, first thing, remember, God is with you. When Moses needed, he reminded in Exodus 33:14, my presence will go with you and I will give you rest. And Psalm 23:4 we read, even though I walk through the valley of shadow. That's a so powerful word. Even though if I walk through the shadow of valley of death, I will fear no evil. As we know that, after giving a great commission, Jesus himself said to his disciples, in Matthew 28:20 we read, surely I'll be with you always. Very ends of the age, I will be with you. He never said that, don't worry, when you call, I'll come. He never said that. He says, I will be with you always. Always he will be with me. At the end of the ages, he says, when you fill with fear, remember the truth and declare the Lord is with me. Say loudly, says, I have no fear because he is here. How many of you believe that God is here? If you feel that God is here, his presence is among us, then there should not be any fear within us. When I was very, very early in my ministry, when I was young, I was as a deacon to my senior pastor. He was 90 plus years. His wife died. He lives alone. First I went and met him. He told me, do you know what is fear? I says, I don't know. You don't know? Then you will survive. I didn't understand that time. I just vaguely answered him. I didn't mean anything what he said. 4 years passed by, I was under him. And I was about to be ordained. He called me and said, you know, first question I asked you, I totally forgot. You know that age when you are young, you forget everything what you speak. You speak anything what randomly what it comes. I says, I don't know. I ask you a very, very good question. And you answered me very boldly. I think God was with you. I says, my God, what is this? So I ask you, do you fear? What is fear? You said, I don't know. People who don't know fear will always be with God. People who don't know fear, they'll be always be a part of Satan. So the devil is the one who brings fear. So when you don't know fear, then it means that God is with you. So practice when you preach. That every time when you preach, tell your congregation, fear is something not with God. It's an enemy of God. So if you are a child of God, fear should not dominate your way of life. I learned that day what he said to me. And from that day, it makes me always something when I get something fear. When fear comes, I get, oh my God, this is not from God. This is something else is coming down. So when we get aware of ourselves, we prepare ourselves. And when we prepare ourselves, God makes us very thing. And if you are filled with fear today, you may, because you are acting like Jesus is not here. If you are believing that God Jesus is here, you will go here without fear from here. Secondly, do not be dismayed, because he is my God. Dismayed means, he says, do not be afraid. So literally means, I look around with anxiety, a state of alarm, and making myself that I'm nowhere to me. But God says to me, in two verses he says, that when you're distressed, you need to understand that I am your God. There are so many people in this world, they can claim that he is our God. They can claim. They can say, oh, all gods are one. No. All roads lead to the same. They can talk. No. Nothing goes like that. I have only one person who died for my salvation. He died for my sin. Instead of me hanging out, he hanged for me. As a communion Sunday, as we remember or recollect, what happened in Calvary is not because of Jesus, it's because of me. It's not because of Jesus. He did not come here to prove himself as a superstar. No, he came to rescue me. So when we know the truth, then we can say that I am not afraid. I am not afraid of it. And thirdly, says, I am convinced totally that I can live without fear because God is with me. I will not be dismayed because he is my God. Not somebody's God. He's my God. And there are promises given by him with confidence that he's going to strengthen me. How much more we wanted? One person told me, instead of having so many morning diet and all, have this drink every day, you'll get more energy, more strength. Having physical energy and strength does not make us healthy. When your spiritual is strong, physical things we can delete. When spiritually we are strong, The word of God is within us and planted within our spirit. That will make us stronger than our physical strength. Physical strength is only a body. Physical strength is only makes us to walk properly or run properly or do things. But spiritual things can shake the whole universe. Every word which proceeds out of your mouth will be of God. So you can turn white into black and black into white. You have power to raise the dead. You have power to make others to counsel. You can pray for them. You can make yourself to make them to realize that Jesus is not only alive today, he is forever. He is not dead. He is not in the grave anymore. He sits beside you and listens to you. Your mind is here listening, or you are listening to something else. Now there is a fashion of having a earphone on their neck and put it in the phone. You never know whether they are listening to us or whether they are listening to the music. Reason is a fashion, became a fashion. One girl came to me for having some rental inquiries. She was having anything. I says, just take it out. I want to take. No, I don't have phone. Just for show. So, we live in a false glamour. We live in a glamorous world. There's no meaning for it. So when you are living in a meaningless life, your life becomes worthy, not before them, but before God. That God appreciates what you do. Okay, these people are meaningless people, but my children are meaningful. They seek me and they wanted me, so I'm going to strengthen them. That's the secret of our strength, not our energy drinks. Oh, you're too tired, man. Have an energy drink. And, you know, I used to work in a store. There's a lot of brands there. They call, keep on saying, you should take Monster, you know. And no, man. Red Bull is fine, man. So all these things is nothing. The one guy told me, a salesman told me, Albert, all this is nothing. Take a glass of water, warm water, 4 spoons of sugar, mix it, drink. That's a real energy drink, not all these ones. So real drink or real energy, not out of our chemicals. It comes within our spirits. We need to understand what God is all about. And not only strengthen, so we need to learn that God strengthens me. We need to learn that one. So when we learn that one, we find more comfort. Isaiah 42:3 says, this passage is quoted in Matthew 12. When you refer to Jesus, bruised, he was broken, reeds he will not break. A dim burning wick he will not extinguish. He will not harm those who are weak. Suffering, he will faithfully bring them to justice. This is an amplified version. That's a King James version. The amplified version says, a broken reed will not break. The dimly burning wick, he will not extinguish. He will not harm those who are weak. And suffering, he will faithfully bring them forth to justice. He will never break us down. He will make us, give us strength to overcome it. And fourthly, trusting God, he will help us. He'll help us because of present promises. He promised so much. In Hebrews 13:6 says, so easily with comfort, the Lord is my helper. I'll not be afraid. What man can do for me? God will never be unfriendly. He will always be with us. In times we seek him, he will help us to overcome our fear. He'll not only help us to overcome the fear, he will make you to understand somebody's helping you. How is it possible? The Bible says, yesterday, today, and forever, he is the same. No change. We may change differently, If you recollect, when I came first in 2000, my body structure, my everything was different. And now if you look at me now, you can see that all my skin is wrinkled. I become a little bit older and look old. So that as the days goes by, our age resembles. But in God's presence, His help does not resemble old. It resembles young every day when you call upon His help. That's the difference. When you think about it, we think that God is near to me because He is my God. So when we say that He is my God, He is always to help us when to come out. And when we think about that, that God will help us to understand that He will uphold us. When He wants to uphold us, He will hold us in a beautiful way. Psalm 40, 145, verse 13 and 14 says, "The Lord is faithful to all the promises of loving towards His own maid." It's not for anybody else, of His own people. "The Lord upholds all those who fall and lifts them up, which He has already promised." I'm not saying, the Bible says. So if He has promised something to do, He's faithful enough to perform it. Do we believe that promises? That's the point. Nowadays they say, we have a promissory note. You write on that promissory note, you stamp it, you register it, you keep it in your locker, you are safe, that belongs to you. But the second part of it, when the time goes by, it has no value. But what the promise made by God is valid for? Ever. And ever. And ever. If my great-grandfather had a promise, it carries to my father's love, then it carries to me and to my kids and to my grandchildren, and I'm going to see my great-grandchildren very soon, then they also, I'm going to see their His promises fulfilled there. Because His promises will never pass away. When you look at things, we need to understand that God is not only says something, He's a performer. He will perform what He says. And when He performs, He does it so wonderfully. I just want to say, give you an example or a small life story of a person, then I want to close it. Most of the people, we know him. His name is Thomas D'Arcy. He's a great songwriter. He was named as honored as a father of gospel music. But to reach to that level, he has to undergo a lot of troubles and problems in his life. And he was very early age, he'd been to school of music in 1921, while he was only 22 years old. And he learned all the musics, and he know composition and the writing. And then he suddenly met Christ's love, and he gave himself and became a born-again Christian. And from then, he stopped going to music clubs. He started writing gospel musics. While he started writing, slowly, when he's getting a little bit of name, nobody wanted to call him as a Christian music director. He was getting humiliated in several things. So he became a pastor. And he became a degree and became a Reverend Thomas D'Arcy. He was the pastor in Chicago. While he was pastoring, one day, there was altar call, so people were lined up, and one person came in front of him. And he handed over, he's having in a paper in his hand, and he just lit like this. And he read that one, he was shocked. How can a loving God can be like this? He read that telegram, he says that just a day ago, his wife died while she was giving birth to a child. And after 24 hours, the newborn child also died. And this man was handicapped. And he don't know what to do, he was just swearing. And the pastor was saying to me, I am writing so many good songs about God, God's love, God's care, everything. And this I hear, what is this? He was totally destroyed. And he decided that not to write any song about God. He went home very much disturbed. 1 week he could not rest peacefully. And he was walking to his friend's place in a music room, and he was playing with the piano. The room was filled with so much of peace within himself. Heavy peace came upon him. And his hands started shriveling, and he started writing something. And while he wrote something, automatically his hand moved to the piano. And he was playing something which is familiar tune. And he put this word into that music. I think we are going to listen to that also. And while he wrote, the first word came, "Precious Lord, take my hand and lead me. Make me to stand because I'm weak." And as we see, we hear that, it makes us to wonder, how is it? That's how it is. When we say that, take my hand, precious Lord, fear not, God is with you. He is your God. He will strengthen you. He will help you. He will hold you. It's like a promise that we got. This somebody wrote like this in 5 different ways. I am your God over you. I am with you. Beside you. I will strengthen you from inside of you. I will help you surround you. I will hold you from underneath you. So God is over you. He is by you. He is inside you. He is around you. He is underneath you. Even though you don't say, Lord, He is with you. When we look at this, I'm just going to close with only one question. Do you believe God is here? If you believe, fear should not dominate. If fear dominates, you are allowing the worldly things to come in. World is against us, but we are not against to the world. We are friendly to them, to tell them the love of Christ and make them what the Calvary all means about it. But when we get fear, we are also joining their group. Let's be away and say, Precious Lord, take my hand. Precious Lord, I'm weak. I'm totally weak, Lord. I don't know how it is. I'm vulnerable to a lot of situations. I'm worried about everything, which is not even mine. But Lord, you hold my precious, your hand. Because I believe your right hand is righteous. Your right hand can strengthen me. And your right hand can make my life better. Let's just close. Loving Heavenly Father, we praise and we thank you. You're a God of understanding. Lord, thank you for this word, Lord. Let every word may be a word of understanding. Make us to understand to the near and to the far. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Now it's our turn to sing. It's a communion Sunday, so I think we have our communion song. Monitor with the working alert. Okay. Your bulletin, Matthew. Let's just turn to our hymnal 410. Jesus paid it all. 410 from our hymnals. If you have just taken, just stand with me. Hymn 410 from our hymnals. Hymn 410 from our hymnals, Jesus paid it all.
Let the Savior sing at the end. Child of weakness, watch it end. Yeah. Calvary Lamb. Jesus paid it all. Alleluia, my own. Saints are left and crimson stain. He washed his white as snow. And in man before the throne
I stand him.
Jesus died my soul to save, my lips to fill with pain. Jesus paid it all, all to you my Lord.
Sing of death the Christmas day.
Sit. As we today as a communion Sunday, as we look back what it means to us, the Bible is very clear as Paul writes about the communion. For I have received from the Lord, which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he has given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same manner, he also took the cup after the supper, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat of this bread and drink of this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes. Therefore, eat this bread or drink this cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner. You will be guilty of his body and his blood of the Lord." So we need to, let every man examine himself, so that let him eat of the bread and the drink of this cup. So when we have gathered here, it is a command to us that we have to examine ourselves. How do you examine? Just close your eyes for a moment and just recollect what is past done. If anything unworthy be done, let's just bow and say to the Lord, "Now forgive me for what I did. I don't want to be an unworthy person of taking your bread and your wine. I should be called worthy. Sanctify me for your thing, because for my sake, you have been on the Calvary. For my sake, you suffered. For my redemption, you shed the blood and made me whole, so that I can freely say that I am a born-again child. By faith I can say that I am going to be with the Lord. By faith I can say I have a Redeemer. By faith I can say that my Redeemer liveth." So when we want to say that, let's just examine for a moment and be in silence and examine and with prayer. This is your bread, which is broken for us. In remembrance of him, let's just have together. As the Bible says, after the supper, he took the cup. When he had given thanks, he said, "This is my blood of the new covenant." So when you're going to join in this new covenant, let's just drink together. Let's just pray. Loving Heavenly Father, we praise and thank you. Lord, we obey your command. As you said, do this in remembrance of me. Till you come and receive us back to you. Lord, we follow what you said to us. Lord, bless us together. Make us to be unified in your presence, that we look upon you as our Redeemer. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So our closing hymn is 469. Have thine own way, I think. If you have just found it, just stand with me. Have thine own way, Lord, have thine own way. Thou art the potter, I am the clay. Mold me and make me after thine will. I am still waiting, yielded and still. Have thine own way, Lord, have thine own way.
and sing. Christ only
fill me with thy spirit till all can see. Christ only always living in me. If you think that I am a child of God, we need to also experience his presence within us. We just not say that God is with me. We mean to experience that God is with us. We need to experience and as a testament to say that God is for me. And when his God is for you and he is your God, then the strength you get and the help you receive, and he holds us. Loving Heavenly Father, I praise and I thank you. I see so many, each and every person who stand before me, Lord, and those who hear to me. Lord Jesus, if anything has to be said, it is only your presence, Lord. As we just now we heard that you are a God, we can just trust on you. When you call upon you, that you are here, Lord. And when you believe that you are our God, your presence is there always. Lord Jesus, we submit ourselves to thee. Let this month be a blessed month, Lord. We don't know what is the seventh month all about. We just started, it's a brand new month. Let this month, everything what we do, let it be according to your will and wish, mighty Father. Let your presence go along with us. Let your sweet abiding grace lead us. Let your strength be strengthen us. Let your help us in what we do. In everything which we do, let Jesus, your name be glorified through us, mighty Father. Lord, once again we praise and we thank you for every person who is standing here and those who are not here. I pray the Lord should bless them and guide them and protect them. In Jesus' name I pray, Lord. Amen. May the grace of God and the fellowship of his Son and the communion of his Holy Spirit be among us, now and forevermore. Amen.